Well, I'm the last speaker for the day, I think. Thought my speech would be very short. But I must tell you that this is part of my training as a civil servant. Because I had a minister who refuses to read any memorandum from me more than 2 pages long. It's quite an intellectual challenge. Well, I think today is the fourth occasion that I'm speaking to university forums. I think the first I spoke was about 4 months ago, where I differentiated between wealth creation and wealth management. So my thrust then was that our education system more or less produces a lot of wealth managers, professionals, you know, lawyers, doctors and so on, engineers. But very few wealth creators. So that's the first problem actually I posed to my university friends here. The second speech I made was seeing the future. How do we see the future with entrepreneurs? Then I made a proposal to the Ministry of Finance that they should give EDB, Economic Development Law, $100 million just to invest in startups. And then just about 2 weeks ago, I spoke to the SMU, not the US, where I spoke about how do we compete in a brick world, BRIC, somebody mentioned to Brazil. We are a tiny red dot, so how do we compete with four giants, India and China in particular? But today, I've more or less put all of these thoughts together. But I'd like to begin by quoting actually a journalist who puts it very succinctly. Mr. David Ignatius of the Washington Post, in an article on March 12 on American higher education, said, when people think about American power in the world, they usually list the country's forbidding arsenal of bombers, aircraft carriers, and troops. Yet, America's asset these days might not be the guns, but its universities. It's a very telling point for me as a Singaporean. So I read all these thoughts together. And this morning, I'll speak on our universities as strategic assets. From one university in the 1950s, when I was an undergraduate and university there, we now have 6 universities, 6 polytechnics, and 3 institutes of technical education. In fact, I was the chairman of our EDB then, and I told the finance minister that what we want to have is 10 ITE graduate schools, technicians, 5 polytechnic people, and only 1 engineer. This is what I call the 10-5-1 problem. And I told him that if you can produce engineers, I guarantee you a job. I was telling him. So actually, if you think about it, Singapore's asset today, we are now, this to Singapore, are very impressed with our skyline, you know, Marina Bay and so on. But actually, our real assets, as Mr. Ignatius said, is in our young graduates, undergraduates, where we educate and nurture in our universities and polytechnics. I just quote some, if you say, random examples of how universities have played an important role in the country's progress. In 1976, I visited China together with Prime Minister Lee Kuan Yew, and we were brought to Beijing University. Then they brought us to a laboratory where the Chinese university engineers, they are developing China's first supercomputer, because of the American embargo, the Saudi embargo on them. And 10 years later, I read in the newspapers that actually China, I think my friends from China can check it out, the new supercomputer is even faster than the American Cray supercomputer. So that's what I mean by strategic. But in this field, that China is a strategy. I mean, that Beta was a strategy except for the Chinese. Similarly, I wanted another case. You know, the Acer computer, Stan Shi, and he was the founder. Taiwan University, the I think, founded the laboratory of semiconductors. And unlike Singapore, where we said that any patent you discover, you must put it under our name. But I think Taiwan, with the KTV, was then the economist. They said, no, you can discover anything new, the patent is yours. And you take it and go out and commercialize it. And that's why China, I mean, Taiwan today is one of the strongest semiconductor manufacturing in the world. This is another example. And now I come here to Singapore. There's a company called Creative Technology, who is a polytechnic graduate. He discovered the sound blaster, which is really the give his company a start in consumer electronics. So I think universities do have this, but so in the city, at this, in a city state, without generous endowment of land, natural resources, and population, maybe you can only compete on knowledge. You know, the legends of our great grandfathers who came here with nothing on their backs and start and got a fortune going. I think those days are gone. Today is all, you're going to be an entrepreneur in the top for 100 richest men in the world. It must be based on knowledge. And knowledge-driven societies have to be built around universities. Because universities are the repositories of impart knowledge to our people. So as a pro-chancellor of NUS, I hope my NUS daughter will not mind me asking, may I be permitted to ask why what may be considered a naive question by all of you? I know that our universities are ranked and faculty promoted largely on a number of research papers published and cited. Great consultation of the number of research papers. But there's something I think my colleague from China mentioned about Confucius and Socrates. Socrates was a great philosopher, and he taught his pupils by asking them questions, never giving them answers. That is the meaning of the Socratic dialogue. In my view, the wrong question poses the greatest threat to good policy making in public administration, including my own Singapore. You ask the wrong question, you get the wrong answer, and you implement the wrong thing. So let me detour a little bit. Tell you a parable about how young crows have to be admitted to adulthood by appearing before a council of elders to answer one simple question. So a first young crow was asked, what's the most dangerous thing for a crow? And he said, oh, an arrow is the most dangerous thing for me. So the elders said, okay, fell aside. Then the next chap came up, asked the same question, and he said, what is the bow, because the bow propels the arrow. And there's a third chap come up, nothing, no bow, no arrow left. So his answer is very simple. He says, a bad archer is the most dangerous thing for a crow, you know? And I think dealing with bad archers in administration is not as simple as it sounds. These are the black swan events, the descent on societies and economies, without warning of prison. That's what most administrators face. So I'll give you an example. So in my experience, the hardest question to answer simply is, what will you succeed in your policy? In the 1950s, you know, with overpopulation threatened developing countries, governments, including Singapore, launched carrot and stick family planning programs. think China today is a one child policy. We were a two child policy country. But I think India, maybe you have a year, you have maybe a one, you've got no restriction. The contraceptive bill can reduce birth rates drastically. Within 2 decades, our rates of birth went from a high of 3.6% to 1.2% today, well below replacement levels. So from a situation of having too many mouths to feed, we now have too few young people to support the old who are living longer. Free from the burden of childbearing of their mother, our daughters and granddaughters now have the freedom to pursue their own careers. I believe that every woman is born with a maternal instinct. The challenge how to arouse the latent instinct smothered by career ambition and other distractions of modern living. In my view, the best way to rekindle this human instinct is to appeal to the innate love for children, which exists in all of us. The worst way, that's why our lesson is to adopt a characteristic transactional policy. Singapore did that. I think China should really look at our example. Our early family planning policy was entirely calibrated to an economic calculus. For instance, the first child is not given any financial incentive because a couple or marriage will have the first child anyway. That's the reason they could have a first child, so why give you any incentive? So the half truth is that some of them do not. And then secondly, young couples are told that they should stop at 2 children. They have to stop at 2 policies. If they ignore the advice of the government, they have to pay the full apportionment fee for the third delivery of the child. And a third child is not given any preference to be enrolled in the school of the oldest sibling. So knowing that this way, I think we do not make the mistake the other way now. Knowing the Singapore psyche, I fear that we will resort to rapid, massive immigration to make up our declining birth rate. We may succeed beyond our wildest dream and wake up to a nightmare instead. This is the dilemma we face today. The sheer size of the population is not a question to answer. It is the quality of the population that counts. URA town planning has calculated that through careful fiscal planning, Singapore can accommodate a larger population of 6.5 million. So my report is, why not 10 million? So, but that, I would say, would be the wrong question to ask. You have to be very careful about it. The wrong question to ask. The real question to ask is, how do we achieve sustainable economic growth? That will depend very much on how rapidly we can scale up our universities. That's why the universities, that's why I think we, our university politics are coming. We have to scale up our knowledge base. But in my view, more than teaching skills and technical knowledge, our universities have a higher role to play. Unlike the civil service, university dorms are detached from the routine of administration. They don't deal with the nitty-gritty. They would have the time to ask what I call what if we succeed type of questions. What I gave you an example of. Their role is, of course, not just to finish such policies proposed by the executive team, myself, as a former civil servant. Any suggestion otherwise, put the back to civil service and ministers up. But by elucidating different dimensions of our national problem, our thinkers in ivory towers can indeed enlighten the legislature to make decision of Singapore, wise decision of Singapore. Parliamentary debates do not end up in uproar, and nobody is the wiser, most of all is electric. To sum up, my challenge for all the adults gathered here is to help the state to ask the right questions, like some practice. I am my speech.